Oasis Audio presents Sir Kendrick and the Castle of Bel Lione by Chuck Black. Read for you by Andy Turvey and Don Marshall.
Kingdom's Heart, an introduction to the Knights of Arrethtrae. Like raindrops on a still summer's eve, the words of a story can oft fall greyly upon the ears of a disinterested soul. I am Cedric of Chessington, humble servant of the prince, and should my inadequate telling of the tales of these brave knights e'er sound as such, know that it is I who have failed, and not the gallant hearts of those of whom I write. For their journeys into darkened lands to save the lives of hopeless people deserve a legacy I could never aspire to pen with appropriate skill. These men and women of princely mettle risked their very lives and endured the pounding of countless battles to deliver the message of hope and life to the far reaches of the kingdom of Arrethtrae, even to those regions over which Lucius, the Dark Knight, had gained complete dominion through the strongholds of his shadow warriors. What is this hope they bring? To tell it requires another story, much of it chronicled upon previous parchments, yet worthy of much retelling. Listen then to the tale of a great king who ruled the kingdom across the sea, along with his son and their gallant and mighty force of silent warriors. A ruler of great power, justice, and mercy, this king sought to establish his rule in the land of Arrethtrae. To this end, he chose a pure young man named Peyton and his wife, Dinan, to govern the land. All was well in Arrethtrae until the rebellion, for there came a time when the king's first and most powerful silent warrior, Lucius by name, drew a third of the warriors with him in an attempt to overthrow the kingdom across the sea. A great battle raged in the kingdom until finally the king's forces prevailed. Cast out of the kingdom and consumed with hatred and revenge, Lucius, known also as the Dark Knight, now brought his rebellion to the land of Arrethtrae, overthrowing Peyton and Dinan and bringing great turmoil to the land. But the king did not forget his people in Arrethtrae. He established the order of the noble knights to protect them until the day they would be delivered from the clutches of the Dark Knight. The great city of Chessington served as a tower of promise and hope in the darkened lands of Arrethtrae. For many years, and through great adversity, the noble knights persevered, waiting for the king's promised deliverer. Even the noblest of hearts can be corrupted, however, and long waiting can dim the brightest hope. Thus, through the years, the noble knights grew selfish and greedy. Worse, they forgot the very nature of their charge. For when the king sent his only son, the prince, to prepare his people for battle against Lucius, the noble knights knew him not, nor did they heed his call to arms. When he rebuked them for their selfish ways, they mocked and disregarded him. When he began to train a force of commoners, for he was a true master of the sword, they plotted against him. Then the noble knights, claiming to act in the great king's name, captured and killed his very own son. What a dark day that was! Lucius and his evil minions, shadow warriors, reveled in this apparent victory. But all was not lost, for when the hope of the kingdom seemed to vanish and the hearts of the humble despaired, the king used the power of the life spice to raise his son from the dead. This is a mysterious tale indeed, but a true one. For the prince was seen by many before he returned to his father across the great sea. And to those who loved and followed him, myself among them, he left a promise and a charge. Here then is the promise. The prince will come again to take all who believe in him home to the kingdom across the sea. And this is the charge. Those who love him must travel to the far reaches of the kingdom of Arrethtrae, tell all people of him and his imminent return, and wage war against Lucius and his shadow warriors. Thus we wait in expectation, and while we wait, we fight against evil and battle to save the souls of many from darkness. We are the knights who live and die in loyal service to the king and the prince. Though not perfect in our call to royal duty, we know the power of the prince resonates in our swords, and the rubble of a thousand strongholds testifies to our strength of heart and soul. There are many warriors in this land of Arrethtrae, many knights who serve many masters, but the knights of which I write are my brethren, the knights of the prince. They are mighty because they serve a mighty king and his son. They are the Knights of Arrethtrae. Prologue. Veil of the Mind. Through the vast realm of Arrethtrae, from the shores of the Great Sea to the Boundary Mountains, from the wasteland of the north to the lush Chessington Valley, the winds of the kingdom flow across the brows of all people of all stature, the meek and the mighty. And behind the brows of most, even those who would otherwise be considered enlightened, hangs a veil. This veil keeps them from knowing the truth about their land, about their kingdom, about their future. What is that truth? Simply, that they are not their own. Every day, even whilst they eat and drink and blindly toil for minuscule advances in life, a great war rages around them. It is a war between light and darkness, good and evil, a battle for their very lives, and most do not see it. One man came to rend the veil of their minds from top to bottom and reveal truth to all who dare look beyond the comfort of ignorance. He was a man of great authority and also great sorrow, for the tearing of the veil cost him his very life. It was the prince who came thus to enlighten the people of Arrethtrae. Those who dare take up his sword and follow him awaken quickly to a world of war from which one would shudder were it not for the sustaining power of the king and his son. Those without the veil of the mind either shrink back or charge forth. For those who choose to move forward into the unseen fray, the stakes appear ever larger, the enemy more formidable, the cause ever more worthy. True courage lies in the heart of one who sees the monstrous form of evil before him, but yields not to the fear that calls retreat. Experience and knowledge give such understanding. Faith in the prince gives such boldness. As the winds wander across the regions of the kingdom, they search for those who bear the mark of the king, whose minds are not veiled in darkness, and whose hearts are strong enough to carry the fight of good to the bastions of evil. In the grasslands of Venery, within the city of Trinalda, stand two knights whom the winds linger near, waiting to discover if their story is worthy. Come, let us join the winds of Arrethtrae and ascertain for ourselves if the saga of Sir Kendrick and Sir Duncan stirs the hearts of men, women, and children to follow the noble prince. Chapter 1. A Glint of the Dark. The tip of the bright silver blade split the air as it plunged towards Sir Kendrick's chest, but the thrust was ill-timed and too committed, considering the advantage Kendrick had over his opponent. Kendrick parried the thrust and countered with a crosscut that threw his opponent into retreat. This seemed to perturb the broad-shouldered young man, who unleashed a wild volley of cuts and slices. Cheers rose from the dozen or so onlookers, each of whom brandished a sword and a look of anticipation. Kendrick found himself working hard to deflect the young knight's clumsy but powerful blows. A slice came close to striking Kendrick's shoulder.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.